Good morning and welcome to the University at Albany Center for Public Health Grand Round Series. I'm Peter Slocum and I'll be your moderator today. Before we begin, I'd like to remind you to please take a moment after the broadcast to fill out your evaluations. Your feedback is very helpful in the development of future programs. Continuing education credits, including nursing contact hours, CME and CHES credits, are available. We'll be taking questions later in the hour, and the toll-free number is 800-452-0662. You may also send your questions to us by fax at 518-426-0696 at any time during the program. We'll remind you before we open the phone lines. Today's program is called Risky Business, Challenges and Opportunities of Communicating in a Crisis. Our guest is Christine Smith, Director of Public Health Risk Communication for the Office of Science and Public Health within the New York State Department of Health. She coordinates risk communication activities related to health emergency preparedness and provides strategic direction relating to communication about emerging diseases and other priority health projects. Previously, she spent 10 years with the Department of Health's Public Affairs Group and was an award-winning radio and television journalist in Albany, New York. Thank you for joining us today, Chris.
Thank you, Peter. You know, this is one of my most favorite subjects.
Yes, indeed. You've worked in the communications business for a good while now, and with all that's changed in the modern media, is it easier or harder to communicate with the public today?
It's more fun.
All right.
And definitely more challenging for a number of reasons. We're all familiar with a 24/7 multimedia environment that we live in. We also have an attention span that generally is in nanoseconds.
Right.
And we have impressive technology, but that technology has a tendency to let us down when we need it most. Witness the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina.
Mm-hmm. In other words, we depend so much on these great new electronic opportunities, but the plug can get pulled.
Internet is great.
Uh-huh.
It's often not there when you need it.
Right.
And we need to keep that in mind when we plan our communication strategies.
Well, let's start out with a general discussion of, or definition of, risk communication.
Can we start out with a discussion of what is a risk?
Okay.
Which is really just the chance that a particular hazard will affect us.
Mm-hmm.
So risk communication, it's a science-based discipline, goes back a number of decades. It's based on myriad research in psychology, sociology, anthropology, speech communication,
mm-hmm.
And it's intended to help people to really understand what the real chance of them being hurt is. It has its background really in environmental health issues. That's a traditional risk communication. Of late, though, we've seen some infectious disease applications as well.
Right. And what's different about communicating with the public in a crisis about risk?
I think crisis and emergency risk communication is really the new iteration
right.
of risk communication. And the traditional model was to hear and address people's concerns when they feared that a risk would hurt them more than scientifically it probably would.
Mm-hmm.
So they had a fear of the hazard that was not in line with the risk that the hazard imposed. Whereas in crisis and emergency risk communication, for the most part, they have a high hazard and a high fear of that hazard, so it correlates. But that makes communicating in a crisis doubly challenging.
Well, what can communications professionals like yourself expect during a crisis?
First of all, that it will not be business as usual.
Uh-huh.
All the communications models and the training that you've had and the abilities that you have in a normal situation will let you down unless you have practiced to be an effective crisis communicator because people are not receiving your message the same way they would in a normal situation. So those intuitive things that you do may not only be ineffective, they may backfire on you. So you need to understand that, and you need to expect that people are going to be going through a lot of emotions in a crisis. There's going to be gossip, rumor and speculation, anger and concern, a lot of emotional factors that get in the way of a rational reception of a message.
I think that's a really important point for people to understand because it's not just the communicator, you in this case, but it's also the receiver. The receptors are different in a crisis than they are when you're just sitting around the breakfast table having a casual conversation.
I think that's the critical point. And a little later, I think I have a slide in there that will show exactly how that message gets distorted. And you know what I'm worried about right now is how are we going to communicate effectively in something, for instance, as challenging as pandemic influenza?
That's right. And you're going to have these all these instant experts cropping up and offering solutions that may or may not be in line with what's really going on.
Yeah, I don't know if instant expert is pejorative phraseology. I use it, so I hope it's not pejorative, but I think it's certainly what happened. And certainly because of this 24/7 multimedia environment, it happens all the time. Before the real experts, those who are on the front lines of the response, are prepared to respond, a lot of people have general knowledge in the area, show up on TV and cable and radio and in the newspaper, talking about what they think might have happened.
Right.
And they have a lot of good theoretical knowledge, but often very little practical knowledge. And as a result, their message is believed, and it may not necessarily be the correct message.
Right. Well, it's very likely, as you just suggested, that we're going to be facing, or that a crisis and communications challenge will be around pandemic flu. And what are some of the things that our audience ought to think about in connection with that an event like that?
Well, first, I think I would caution communicators that we have to start that dialogue with the audience. Certainly, we've been alerting people about the need to prepare. But I think we need to be very frank about the challenges of a pandemic, as opposed to, say, challenges of a natural disaster, even a very bad one. In a natural disaster, it's generally fairly localized, a terrorism attack, generally fairly localized, and you can count on help from other sectors. A pandemic, by its very nature, is global, which means that everybody will be dealing with it at the same time. And there's not likely to be that hero in a white hat coming over the, I think I'm mixing some analogies with
That's
the cavalry
right.
coming
right.
to the rescue. But hopefully that point gets out there. And I think we need to have a dialogue about these really tough decisions, including a rationing scarce health resources. I want to read you a quote, if I could, from Peter Sandman, because
right.
I think it really is very germane to this discussion. And he says, "Inevitably, fairness will be a key issue. In a widespread public health crisis, scarce medical resources will need to be allocated to those in the most critical occupations rather than to those who are most vulnerable. Cops and waterworks managers and nurses will get priority over seniors and children. We need to think this through now, balancing practicality and compassion." Now, I don't know if Peter is exactly right about who will get it,
right.
but I think that discussion has to happen right now, because people are going to operate from their prior beliefs, which is we all get what we need, essentially.
And that
may take a little while, but
that certainly runs counter to the standard thinking that children and seniors go first.
Right.
And here we're talking about emergency workers may need protection before other people.
And I'm not saying that that decision has been made, but if it's a decision that should be made, it needs to be made really from a two-way interactive discussion and not from the top down and then imposed on people.
And it needs to be a subject of communication now,
exactly.
up front, rather than waiting till the crisis hits.
And the reason that that has to happen is when the crisis hits, the effect of communication will be distorted by what's called noise in the channel. And those of us who took communications, Communications 101, the slide you're seeing right now is the model of how a message is received, sent and received. This is a model that was developed by a couple of mathematicians called Shannon and Weaver back in the 1940s, and it's really simple. A sender sends a message through a channel and it gets to a receiver. But what these gentlemen theorize is that it never ever gets there without just being distorted. Think about the game of telephone that some of us
right.
played when we were kids.
Right.
A message would go out and we'd whisper to someone in the room, and by the time it got to the ultimate receiver, it didn't sound like anything like what the message started out.
Right.
And that's what happens in an emergency as well. Now, Shannon and Weaver were talking about physical noise, and they were talking about radio waves and static that distorts them. But that happens in an emergency as well. We often see physical noise. Think about the aftermath of the World Trade Center disasters, Hurricane Katrina. You couldn't use your cell phone.
Right.
The two-way radios malfunctioned. Or even those operating lines that were still in business,
right.
Too many people were calling in at the same time, and therefore that message could not be received. The slide I'm showing you now, I think this is a sculpture. I certainly hope it's not a traffic signal.
It's not your Christmas tree.
If you drove up to that, I mean, would you know whether to stop or go or yield, or what would you think? Because there's too much input coming in,
right.
And that's what happens during a crisis. And there's many other sources of noise as well.
Have we made progress across the country at clearing up some of those physical noise issues, the straightening out the communications channels, for instance, between first responders that came up both in Katrina and 9/11?
Mm-hmm. You know, that's a great question, and I'm glad you asked, because I can't give you the answer.
Okay.
What I can tell you is that organizations such as the New York State Department of Health and others are working very hard to work their way through that. For instance, we're using some ham radios and working with ham radio operators.
Mm-hmm.
But the question you asked really is outside of my expertise.
Okay.
And so as hopefully good crisis communicator, I wouldn't answer that, because one of the rules is you don't answer a question that is outside your area of expertise. And it's okay to say, I don't know. If you don't know, you're not supposed to know.
Right.
If you should know, though, you better have that answer in advance, or at least promise to get the information out very quickly.
Right, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in
Absolutely.
Detail in the program. Well, I imagine language plays a significant role, too, both because we have such a diverse population in our society and because of other experiences that may get in the way of people understanding crisis communications.
Oh, precisely. And I refer to them as literal barriers. And it's not just that people don't speak English. They may speak English but have a low literacy level, so some of our very scientific-sounding smart publications are not very helpful at all. Or concepts, because of cultural differences, simply may not translate at all. I don't know if the audience can actually read that sign, but I think it's really, really very descriptive of what can happen. This particular sign says, for restrooms, go back toward your behind.
I see.
Now, you know, I think we kind of get the message, and it's not an emergency, so, well, it might be an emergency if we're talking about restrooms, but it's
right.
not a crisis.
Right.
But still, it's not clear communication.
Right.
And it's what we run into in trying to translate our messages to a diverse audience, those who might have cultural barriers, trust issues.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to be very cognizant of that. We need to understand that it's going to happen and plan on how we can effectively communicate despite that.
Right. And it's not that that you're concerned about translation issues at the bathroom entrance, more the question of making sure you understand as the communicator how your message is, that it's going to be clearly received with the right language so people can get it.
Absolutely. One of the rules of social marketing, you are not your audience. And so when we have to communicate to a diverse population, we have to understand that we don't have all the answers, and we have to align ourselves with the trusted leaders and the opinion leaders who do know the issues and can help guide our communication or get them through the effective channels. So we do need to reach out and partner broadly.
All right, what are some of the common public reactions to the news of impending disaster or emotional events that are coming at you?
Well, and these are psychological barriers or psychological noise, and unfortunately, I think we're all too familiar with them, you know, in many of our states now. Certainly, as a New Yorker, I experienced them after 9/11. Denial, confusion, anxiety, anger and concern. We may have been left feeling helpless or hopeless. Our fight or flight impulse may have engaged.
Mm-hmm.
Denial especially, I mean, I remember watching those towers come down and saying to myself, this can't be happening.
Right.
I'm denying that it's happening. And I certainly felt anxious and confused and angry.
Right.
And certainly the victims of Hurricane Katrina or our local flooding here in New York State, the victims in Mumbai the other day.
Exactly.
This is going to happen, and this emotional response gets in the way of being able to clearly think about, well, what do I do next to reduce my risk in this
but
emergency.
But it's a real response, and we have to deal with it. I mean, it's a real human, honest response, and we have to be prepared to deal with it.
It's going to happen. We have to assume it's going to happen and figure out in advance how do we communicate around that. And a lot of it is communicating before these responses engage, which means communicating before the fact so that people will then have some prior beliefs to base their response on.
Now, is this what you mean by the term I've seen, vicarious rehearsal?
Yeah, vicarious rehearsal really refers to armchair victims. Mm-hmm. And it's a product of, again, our 24/7 global multimedia societies, where something can happen any place in the world, and we will see that, and our emotional response will be, ooh, could that happen to me? Mm-hmm, and then we'll start thinking, well, what would I do if indeed it happened to me? You know, you feel like you're experiencing it, even though it's happening far afield. One caution to that, though, is that people who are experiencing this vicarious rehearsal will be less likely to pay attention to risk reduction advice because they know it's not happening here. Even though they're worried about, they do have a certain level of comfort that it is happening somewhere else. So,
So the psychology of people riding the subway systems in the United States this week after the Mumbai attack is mixed up in that, you're saying, that they could see it happening elsewhere, but they sort of think, well, it's not here, really?
Well, you know what's entering into that? Something called an optimism bias, and research shows that, if I'm getting this number wrong, I apologize, but about 90% of people figure that bad things are going to happen, but not to them.
Right.
It's an optimism bias, and I think we probably need it in order to go about our daily lives,
right.
But that makes it really hard to communicate the true extent of a risk. And that's probably what's happening with the subway. People need to ride the subway. They're going to take their chances and be grateful for any interventions and bag searches that may be taking place. But on the other hand, they're going to go about their lives.
Right. Well, does this vicarious rehearsal idea lend itself to what we call the worried sick phenomenon?
Yeah, it does. It absolutely does. And I'm glad that you referred to it as the worried sick, because in the very recent past, at least in public health circles, this was referred to as the worried well.
Mm-hmm.
And these are people who, because of these psychological responses, are experiencing these multiple unexplained physical symptoms. Unfortunately, there's no reason for them to become ill, but this concern does result in symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
And these symptoms need medical attention.
Mm-hmm.
They can't just be disregarded.
Right.
And it puts a strain on healthcare resources. And even if they don't result in symptoms that require intervention by a doctor, we've seen research after 9/11 showing that it dramatically increased people's reliance on alcohol and maybe revert to drug use and things, self-destructive behaviors as a result of these impulses. And it can also result in stigmatization. We may, as a society, decide that some group is to blame for whatever crisis has ensued. They're the Typhoid Marys of the present-day crisis.
Right.
And then we point fingers, as happened in SARS, when some people were afraid to go to Chinese restaurants. And that's really unfortunate. We need to, as communicators, see how we can work to prevent that.
Right. Now, this area you want to get into next is a fascinating area of how people react differently to different kinds of crises or emergencies, and it relates directly to your communication challenges.
Yeah, and again, this is all based on research, and I didn't do the research, but I'm talking about research that has been done by a number of very gifted experts, and they show that there's a real issue with risk perception.
Mm-hmm.
And bottom line, all risks are not accepted equally.
Right.
There are some that we will deal with, and there are others that we just find unacceptable.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a number of reasons for that. For instance, if the risk is voluntary on our part, we choose to accept it, we're okay with that.
Right.
Well, if it's involuntary, well, sorry, that's not acceptable.
Mm-hmm.
If it's controlled by us rather than others, then we feel better about that risk. And as an example, how'd you get here today, Peter?
I drove my car here.
You drove your car. I drove my car. I always feel safe behind the wheel of my car.
Right.
And when I get into an airplane, I know that I have a far greater chance of getting injured or killed in an auto accident than I do in a plane crash.
Mm-hmm.
But I have a few seconds of trepidation. Why? Because I know my skills behind the wheel, and I'm not sure whether the pilot has had a bad day or didn't get enough sleep, and that risk is not within my control, so it affects me a little more profoundly. Similarly, if it's a risk that we're familiar with versus a brand new threat, we're more willing to accept it.
Mm-hmm.
Take West Nile virus. When that emerged in New York State in 1999, people were calling the health department because they saw a fly on their screen door.
Right.
They figured that's close enough to a mosquito. I'm worried about that.
Right.
And now our communication around West Nile virus has moved into social marketing, where we're really trying to persuade people to do things to protect themselves from a risk that they're now familiar with and not so much worried about.
Right.
So we have to deal with that as well. Natural versus man-made, and that's, of course, the difference between radon gas, which can be a health threat,
right.
often is a health threat, and radiation from a nuclear power plant. And I think we all know which one is more acceptable to the general public. Reversible versus permanent risk, I mean, that just makes sense. You know, if it's a choice between breaking my leg and breaking my neck, I'll probably go for the activity that, you know, if I voluntarily accept the chance of breaking my leg.
Right.
Fairly versus unfairly distributed risks, which goes to the idea of environmental justice.
Right.
And, you know, where is that trash burning plant located and why isn't my neighborhood outside of my control?
Right.
And then if a risk affects children, it absolutely is much less acceptable, and I think all of us as parents understand why.
That's right, and the involuntary risk gets into the, as you know, I work with the Cancer Society, we work on the question of secondhand smoke, and there we're imposing a risk on some other people who are not smokers, but it's now been found that there's an extraordinarily high risk from the toxins there, and the people who were victimized, including children, are getting the smoke involuntarily, so that's that kind of risk.
And obviously, many smokers have stopped because they are worried about the effect on their children.
Yeah,
they're
exactly.
willing to accept the risk for themselves. Probably that optimism bias has kicked in.
Right.
But when they see what could happen to their kids, that's when they stop.
That's
so
right.
that risk that affects children is not acceptable.
Let's talk about some of the key points to keep in mind when communicating with the public during a crisis.
I think the most important component is not to try to be comforter-in-chief. Do not overly reassure. And it's our tendency because, you know, if we have a response role, we feel it is our obligation to make people feel okay.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's our obligation to be honest and to give them the best advice to reduce their risk. My personal opinion is you need to be very careful not to be falsely reassuring. It's important to overestimate rather than underestimate because people have, research has shown that people will be more accepting of a estimate that's modified to downward than if you have to modify it upward. And in plain English, that means if you have done the computer model and it shows that this threat could potentially kill or injure 200 to 500 people, if you choose to say that your best science says that at least 200 people could be injured, and then it turns out that 399 people are injured, you're not trusted. You got it wrong.
Right.
On the other hand, if you had said up to 500 people and it was 399, you must have, you know, worked as hard as you could to make that risk less imposing on people. So, you know, that's a difficult one because people want to be reassuring.
Right.
And reassurance is necessary, but not false reassurance. So I think that's the point I would really want to make.
I really like that term you use, comforter-in-chief. Don't try to be the comforter-in-chief because it is, you're right, it is a tendency, and then people, if people look and get a false answer from you, then it's throwing away that trust, which is very hard to get back.
You can't get it back. Once your trust is lost, especially in a crisis, you will not get it back. There's a theory called the trust determination theory that talks about how you get to be trusted in a crisis situation. But one of the things you have to do is not get caught in a lie.
Right.
And even if you're perceived as having lied, you will not get that credibility back, and credibility may be your most important quality.
But at the same time, we have this problem of never having the full set of facts that you would love to have. And so how cautious do you have to be in relaying the hard information that is partial, and you don't want to be overly comforting, as you say, when you've got positive information, but you have positive information you need to get out there too.
Yeah, and there are techniques, and these are really just communication techniques that will help you with that. And one of those is when the news is good, if things are finally starting to come under control, put it in parentheticals. State the continued concern before giving them the good news. For instance, there's some examples on
the
screen.
We're not out of the woods yet.
Yeah, we're not out of the woods yet. We've seen a declining number of cases each week, and although the fires could still be a problem, we have them 85% contained. Mm-hmm. I actually saw Dr. Julie Gerberding, who is the director of the Centers for Disease Control right. and Prevention, back at the time that SARS first emerged. She was asked, could this be terrorism? Mm-hmm. And obviously, there was small chance that it was terrorism. Right. But Dr. Gerberding did not dismiss that out mm-hmm. of hand. And her actual reply was something to the effect of, while we have no reason to believe this could be terrorism, mm-hmm. we are not dismissing any possibility. Right. And then she went on to explain why it looked very much like a natural threat.
Right.
So she did not say, you know, right off the bat, no, we're 99% and 44%, 100% sure
right.
that this is a newly emerged agent, but mm-hmm. natural. She did allude to the possibility that it could be worse
right.
than, in fact, what it turned out to be.
Right, right. And that goes to your point, I think, of the next slide of under-promising and over-delivering.
Right? Yeah, absolutely. And again, when you say, what can we say when the situation is emergent and we don't have all the information? Well, you can talk about what you are doing. You can't promise about the outcome unless you've got a crystal ball that's working particularly well on a given day. But you can explain all the things that you are doing to come to the result that everybody wants. So explain about the process. Explain what you think the issue mm-hmm. is, all of the things you are doing to combat the challenges, what you think will occur as a result, and also tell people how they're going to get the information as it changes. An emergency is an emergent situation. We need to constantly keep aware of that.
Right. And even though in describing that process, you're leaving holes or mm-hmm. indications of things that have yet to be done to get answers, just giving people the sense that there's a process in place to get those answers is helpful to them.
Yeah, and having said that, though, I really need to stress that you can't be bureaucratic and we have a plan. Uh-huh. We can't tell you what the plan is because it's security reasons,
right.
but we do have a plan, just trust me. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is not the way to go about it.
Right.
You know, if we're talking about an infectious disease, we need to be able to say something to the effect of, we do have an unexplained cluster of illnesses mm-hmm. in whatever part of the country or
right.
state. We are doing this surveillance to see if we have any patterns of illness.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, this is what this surveillance entails.
Right.
We plan to do X, Y, and Z afterwards, and then we plan to tell you what we found and at a stated time.
Right, right.
Bring people into the process. An emergency is a shared dilemma.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just up to a few people, despite their job titles, to be parental, to decide, yeah. to announce, to defend, and then tell people, just do as I say, and you'll be just fine. It will not be accepted.
Nor do we need them to try to impress the public with all the acronyms they can think up and drive into one sentence.
Right? And you know what? In public health, we're particularly, I would say, guilty of this.
Mm-hmm.
Not just acronyms, but the jargon.
Right.
The one I love is, we're going to prophylax the population.
Right.
Well, I don't know if everybody really knows what we mean by that.
Right.
And based on prior beliefs, they may have some other thoughts. So we're not speaking clearly. So we need to use plain language.
Right.
We need to get rid of the acronyms. And certainly in public health preparedness, we have a number of them. I can't even keep up with them. But even something as simple as CDC.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, because we know that, but others may not know what we mean by CDC.
Exactly.
Maybe it's the Canadian Development Corporation.
Indeed. The Canadian Broadcasting? Oh, that's CBC.
CBC, yes.
Are there some tips about how to help reduce anxiety in your communications with the public that you want to give us?
Not only are there tips, but,
mm-hmm.
but it's critical to know what they are and to use them, because that helps people make that risk within their span of control
mm-hmm.
and makes them more accepting of the risk, and importantly, the ways that they can reduce that risk for them and their family. And some of the things that we can do is to understand that anxiety is reduced when people can take action steps. Symbolic behaviors are mm-hmm. often very helpful. preparatory behaviors, such as we are advising now because of the potential for a pandemic. Mm-hmm. We're asking people to stockpile 2 weeks of food and other essential supplies. Contingent if-then behaviors. Mm-hmm. If this happens, then what will you do? For instance, if you cannot get back to your home, where will your family members meet? Mm-hmm. In flooding, that's a perfect example. People right. may think if there's something bad happens, let's all go back to the home and huddle together. Well, what if you can't get back to your home? Then what do you do? What if your local phone lines are down? How do you communicate? Need to plan these in advance. And also, it helps if you give people a three-part action plan, you know, X, Y, and Z, mm-hmm. rather than just that, do this and you'll be just fine.
Mm-hmm. Why does the three-part plan help to reduce their anxiety?
Puts it within their control, makes it within their own choice. Uh-huh. It's not decide, announce, defend. It's here are some options. We think all of them are valuable. Mm-hmm. You're a partner in this shared dilemma, and we count on you to make a good decision.
And your circumstance may be different than mine. So
absolutely, we're not mm-hmm. we're not all the same.
Right. Now, should we allow people to feel their fear?
I think we should encourage people to feel their fear, and that happens so rarely. Certainly there have been very effective examples of crisis communication when that was encouraged, but for the most part, I think people in leadership roles think they have to be very stoic mm-hmm. and convince people to be stoic as well. How often have we heard say, there's no need for undue alarm, mm-hmm. When in fact the situation is quite concerning. So when we're telling people they need to be stoic, what we're saying is, you know, this is a concerning situation, but you need to buck up. Mm-hmm. And so they're worried. They feel helpless or hopeless, mm-hmm. and now they also feel guilty for a natural and expected response. So we need to validate that response, and then they'll trust us more if they mm-hmm. understand that this is a worrisome situation, and we're not trying to make it seem less worrisome. You know, we're all in this together. They might wonder what's the matter with us if we can't see that the sky is falling when it really is.
I'm worried about my kids getting the flu, obviously, so it's a rational reaction.
Exactly. It's also an emotional reaction,
right.
You know.
Sure.
And they're processing information in a different part of their brain, and research has shown that as well. A very emotional, visceral reaction, and if we don't validate that, they just stop trusting us.
Right. And you can use that fear, I mean, obviously, to say, here are three things that you can consider mm-hmm. to do to help protect your kids or whatever the right situation is.
Right. I mean, I think then. I may not be wording this precisely as I would have had I taken my chance to make my message maps, but I think you have to say, we understand why you are concerned by this particular situation. We are concerned as well, and here is what we are doing so that we can reduce all of our risks.
Right.
And here is what we would suggest you do, based on all we know so far, mm-hmm. to help reduce your risk. And here are several options.
Right. What can we expect the public to ask of you, us, in an emergency situation?
What would you ask?
How do I fix it? How do I prevent my kids from getting sick or whatever?
Bottom line,
right.
Am I safe? Is my family safe?
Right.
You know, what do I need to do to stay safe or to reduce my risk? What have you found out about this? I'm really concerned. What do mm-hmm. I need to know? Because knowledge is power. What caused it, and importantly, can you fix it? And that's a tough one,
right.
Because at this point, you may not know that you can fix it, or you know that it's going to take quite a bit of effort and time to do so,
right.
But you need to then go with the process. And you need to say, this is a devastating situation. It will not be fixed overnight, mm-hmm. but here is what we've done so far, here is what we plan to do next, and here is what you can do to help to solve this problem that affects us all.
I'm curious whether there have been studies to look at whether those kinds of questions or the thinking of the public has changed at all since 9/11, since Katrina, because certainly in Mumbai this week, mm-hmm. certainly we all have suffered an encroachment of our optimism factor there. We certainly realize that the world is a different place than we thought it was, maybe. And are people more likely to be believing the possibility of a disaster striking them now?
You know, Peter Sandman talks about something called an adjustment reaction. Is that that's when the novel risk strikes. You know, we go through vicarious rehearsal, and we go through being overly fearful, and then as a little time passes, we adjust to the risk because we have to, because otherwise we can't go about our daily lives. And, you know, I think that's probably what happens. And even with risks that we really need to pay attention to, there's something called message fatigue. You're just sick of hearing about it.
Right.
And that may be the case with pandemic influenza right now. I think we probably have people who are on a spectrum. On one side is irrational concern, and another is irrational complacency. Right. And what we need to do is to bring them to a point that we could responsibly refer to as aware and prepared. And I think that that's going to be a continuing challenge for us.
Speaking of continuing challenges, I know you've spent a number of years in the media and working with the media, and that's a major way that you need to communicate with the public through the media. But they're going to ask different questions necessarily many times than the public asks, and how to line those things up is a tricky business.
Well, who, what, where, when, why, how are absolutes. And as a matter of fact, research Dr. Vincent Covello conducted looked into the questions, the 77 most frequently asked questions in an emergency, and there's a list of them that, that's out there on the internet if anybody wants to refer to that. What's happened? Who's in charge? Has this been contained? Are the victims being helped? What can we expect now? What should we do? And then now we get into the blame game. Why did this happen? Did you have forewarning? What did you know and when did you know it? And of course, you need to understand that news is visual. Even if you're talking about radio, it's visual because they create mind pictures.
Right.
But all the other formats are also visual, so they're going to be looking for photo ops as well. You need to understand that. And that blame game is interesting because I think pre-Katrina, we would have a little more leeway to try to get our response in gear. And the media are often the most effective partners in an emergency. They're part of the community. They want to be part of the solution. But as a result of Katrina, I think they probably will be much quicker to ask, you know, why did this happen? Did you have forewarning? And why weren't you prepared?
Right. So it's sort of like losing the trust you talked about before. It's having had a bad performance for whatever reason in all levels of government, then the public clearly got that message. Now the media is now believing there's a likelihood of that happening again.
Yeah, and you're not going to get the wiggle room that you would have had.
Right.
So that means you need to prepare in advance. But media being media, and since I come from those ranks, it's, this is not a criticism, it's just a reality. The question is also going to be asked, are you over-preparing? Are you wasting valuable taxpayer dollars getting ready for something that potentially won't ever happen? And I think that question occasionally is asked about pandemic preparedness. And on the other hand, you know, the actual risk that those levees would break in New Orleans was fairly low. But the consequences, should it happen, was known to be devastating. And unfortunately, the planners in that case went with a very low risk rather than planning for the devastating consequences. And we saw what happened. So
that's
we can't allow that to happen in the future.
Now, is there a way to, this sounds sort of a naive question, but is there a way to manage the communication, risk communication process here?
There is, let's just say that the most effective risk communication will not in and of itself solve the problem. But ineffective communication will arguably make it much, much worse. So you need to know, what are you going to release? When are you going to release it? How will you release your information? Where will you release it? Should you go to the scene of the disaster? Or should you, you know, be in the state capital or nation's capital with flags behind you? Who should tell the public about it? And what's your motivation for letting them know? And in an infectious disease crisis, by the way, the World Health Organization recommends that the reason that you release information is because it can help people to reduce their risk of illness or death. And they say that you cannot hold on to that information the minute that having that information would allow the public to take an action that would benefit them. They say that it is just not right to hold it past that moment.
We owe the public an opportunity for them to take steps to protect themselves if they're available.
Absolutely.
Right.
Again, anything less is that decide, announce, and defend very parental approach that will not engender trust and, as a matter of fact, will be much less effective.
same principle public health uses in basic disease transmission. If we know how the disease is transmitted, HIV, then we have an obligation to let people know about that so they can take steps to reduce their risk.
Absolutely. Right. Even if we're not sure about the extent of the transmission, and even if it will lead to hard questions about, well, why don't you know more?
Right.
We need to get that information out there.
Right. Let's talk a little bit about how to build trust with the public. And of course, there's the famous example right here in New York of the Mayor Giuliani's performance in 9/11.
Yeah, absolutely. That was a model for building trust. And again, it refers back to this trust determination theory, which states that there are five essential elements to being trusted. And the first is to express empathy. Mm-hmm. And the research shows you have 30 seconds to do that. Often you do it verbally, but your body language or other elements can also express empathy. You need to be competent and appear to be competent. Mm-hmm. You need to be honest and appear to be honest and open. You need to be committed and you need to be accountable. And that last means not shifting the blame, not saying it wasn't our fault, it was the other agency's fault, or as unfortunately happened in the aftermath of Katrina, legitimate complaints about things that weren't done were in fact viewed as trying to shift blame. You know, it's just not the time for it. There is a time for after action reports and making things better. But if you're accountable, accept your accountability and, you know, convince people that you're going to do the best that you can.
Right. Now, why is speed so important in getting information out?
Yeah, and this is, again, risk communication research, that the speed of your message is a marker for how people perceive your preparedness. If you are not the first out there with your message, then you are not in control of the message. The instant experts will have already pontificated on what the situation is, and they're bound to be wrong, at least in the specific details, because they're not on the front lines. But when you finally get around to telling all you know, if it's different from what people have already heard or learned, they believe the other guy and not you. And an example of that, and this is not something that might have been prevented, but it's certainly something that I dealt with, was when West Nile virus emerged and we were asked, well who's the highest risk? There was no research to help us
to
know who
really
was at the highest risk. So we trotted out the usual suspects.
Kids
we said that
people,
we believed it would be elderly, children, and those who are immunocompromised.
Right.
Well, it turned out that two of those three were correct, but kids were not at a higher risk after the serological surveys were conducted. But for 2 to 3 years afterwards, I had to continue to call media outlets that kept suggesting that kids were at a higher risk because they heard it, they believed it. Very hard to counter beliefs once they're already in place.
That's right. That's right. Well, what's the goal of the initial message to the public in the onset of an event of some kind?
Well, without appearing falsely reassuring, it is important to ease people's concern so that they can get rid of some of that mental and psychological noise and listen to what they need to hear and take the actions they need to take. You need to give guidance on how to respond. And again, that's usually going to encompass a three-part action plan. You say, you should do X, but you could do Y. At least do Z. Three-part action plan.
Right. And it needs to be short and crisp at the beginning.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
Can you offer some advice for people who are watching today who might be playing your role as spokespersons for an agency in a crisis anywhere around the country?
Yeah, I think you really need to, first of all, understand that this is difficult. As good as you are in an emergency, things change. So practice and train. And your goal, your ultimate goal, is to be an effective communicator to get the messages out there that will reduce people's risk of injury or death and remove those psychological barriers that get in the way of people understanding critical information. And so you have to be trusted. You have to be the face of your organization. Move it from that bureaucratic it to a we, a shared dilemma. We're all in this together. You know, and I've spoken a few times about that three-part action plan.
Right.
And in case people need an example of it, it's what we're suggesting in terms of pandemic preparedness. We are suggesting that right now people should stockpile 2 weeks of essential supplies to have them on hand in case of a pandemic.
Right.
if that's not enough, if they feel they need to do more, they could, and we'd actually appreciate it if they'd volunteer to get involved in pandemic preparedness throughout their communities. Mm-hmm. But if they're unwilling to do either of that, they've got this optimism bias that it's never going to happen,
right.
At least stay informed mm-hmm. about, you know, how a pandemic is potentially emerging so that it won't come as a complete surprise. So
right.
could do X, please do Y, at least do Z.
Right. And your primary goal as a spokesperson is to do that, get the public thinking in the right direction, and ultimately, as you say in one of your slides here, reduce the incidence of illness, injury, and death.
Certainly from a public health perspective, that's why we come to work every day.
Right.
And in an emergency, it's all the more critical to be an effective communicator, and unfortunately, it's that much more challenging for all of these very real reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And if we don't practice, if we don't think about this in advance, if we don't get the training we need, we will be saying things that will be inconsistent, will not be perceived as credible, and people will then make up their own mind based on you know, their individual experiences. That's something called anchoring.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have good, solid information quickly,
right.
I'm not just going to sit there and accept what happens to me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to do whatever I think is going to be helpful. And then we in public health and other response roles might say, well, people are panicking.
Right.
Well, that's not right. Panicking is when you take actions that would arguably lead to a bad result.
Mm-hmm.
And people are generally taking actions that they think are best for them because they don't have clear guidance soon enough.
Right. So to judge in judging the message that you're putting out, I know your slide talks about speed again as the marker for
Absolutely.
Preparedness and the facts that you have to be consistent.
Right, yeah. And you know, that seems so simple. But look at when we have a flood, and then we often tell people, well, you need to boil your water.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Well, some people say you should boil it for 1 minute, and others for two, and
right.
third for three. And then I'm sitting at home hearing that I should boil my water, and take your best guess.
Right.
Doesn't engender a lot of trust. Am I going to really depend on information from
mm-hmm.
that source later on when the experts themselves don't agree?
Right.
So
right.
that's a real challenge as well.
Let's get into some of the practical do's and don'ts that you've prepared here. What are the most important lessons that communication professionals should learn for dealing with a crisis?
Well, I guess from the perspective of tell them again, tell them what you told them, I'm going to say plan ahead.
Mm-hmm.
You've heard this throughout, you know, the
right.
course of our conversation, but it's critical.
Mm-hmm.
You do need to understand that bad things can happen to good
mm-hmm.
localities and to plan for those because you need to be able to respond quickly. The first 24 hours will tell the tale.
Mm-hmm.
Also, you need to be straightforward and don't hide behind your jargon or your statistics or scientific knowledge. Talk frankly and
mm-hmm.
treat people as legitimate partners. Be accurate, which is difficult in an emerging situation where the facts are changing all the
right.
time.
Right.
But the way to do this is to state, this is what we know right now.
Mm-hmm.
Here, by the way, is how we came to this knowledge. And here's what we're doing to quantify this knowledge. And if it changes, you're going to know about it as soon as we do.
Right.
Because we do need to strive to reassure, to be trusted as a source,
mm-hmm.
as well as to inform and without falsely reassuring.
Right, right.
And also, you know, exhibiting compassion.
Mm-hmm.
That's key. You have 30 seconds to persuade people that you really care. And
right.
if you don't care, they don't care about you. Will Rogers said they don't care that you know
mm-hmm.
until they know that you care.
Huh,
and that was the Rudy Giuliani model in New York City
mm-hmm.
after 9/11. And I don't have this quote precisely, but when asked how many people had died, his answer was something to the effect of, not as many as we feared, but far more than we could bear.
Right.
I mean, there's no better way to say it than that. And one of the reasons that he was able to say it so well
mm-hmm.
was that he came up with message maps
mm-hmm.
for an attack on a landmark building in the wake of the first World Trade Center attack.
Right.
Now, you may say, that seems kind of cold and calculated. It doesn't.
Right.
It seems very professional and understanding that as a communicator,
mm-hmm.
If you're looked to for leadership, your communication skills may be the most important countermeasure that you have.
Right, and it helps, in that case, the leader, the mayor, appear and or broadcast the sense that he was in control and in command, which the public needs too.
Yeah, he didn't need to tell everybody he was comforter in chief. Just by understanding that he really did care, and being able to be trusted, he served the role of Comforter-in-Chief,
right,
and without falsely reassuring at any point.
Right. Okay, now on the flip side, you have a don't slide or two,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, and I put this in here because I think, especially on the part of many leaders, there is that optimism bias that a terrible thing will never happen here. And certainly, we all hope that nothing as horrible as terrorism or bioterrorism or pandemic flu will happen. But as we've seen of late, natural disasters happen all the time, and they can be very, very problematic. So, you know, plan ahead, and don't assume it will never happen mm-hmm. here. And don't allow someone else to define your issues. And that happens when they get out there first with a message.
Mm-hmm.
So don't delay that information release until you're 100% sure. Because when will you be 100% sure? Well, probably many years in the future when you're writing the journal article.
Or you have all the lab reports that you could possibly
exactly.
dream of.
Exactly.
Right?
But right now, it's a developing situation.
Right.
You know, new facts are emerging. You will not be 100% sure. So as soon as you know that there's an issue that can be helped by communicating the facts, you have an obligation to communicate those facts. And don't provide false reassurance. And mm-hmm. I know I'm becoming kind of a mantra on that. Mm-hmm. But it's important for trust and credibility. And another way that you can engender trust, by the way, is because there are so many people out there giving so many messages, try to synchronize your message with trusted sources in the community. It's a concept of third-party verifiers,
mm-hmm.
but trusted leaders, opinion leaders, faith community leaders. Research shows, by the way, that healthcare providers are very trusted to give information in a health crisis, so we need to engage them as well.
And I think the most important item here on your next slide is don't get caught in a lie.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that seems fairly simplistic.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get caught in a lie. But what's important to remember is that you can lie by omission.
Mm-hmm.
You can lie by misdirection.
Mm-hmm.
That's referred to as spin.
Mm-hmm.
And risk communication is not spin control.
Right.
It has no bearing at all on spin control, and there should be none of that in your risk communication. So,
right.
And by the way, you'll get caught. You will always get caught.
Right.
And then you won't be trusted, and then you might as well just take your PSAs and news releases and mm-hmm. your microphone and go home, because
right.
you won't be an effective communicator.
Right. What are some of the pitfalls to avoid, Chris?
Well, in a crisis situation, as we discussed, there's going to be a lot of anger and concern. And if you are the person who is the face of this crisis,
mm-hmm.
people who don't have anybody else to blame or be angry at are going to be angry at you, arguably.
Mm-hmm.
And you are also a human being who are dealing with complex emotions, working probably 18, 20 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be very instinctive to attack back and to tell people why, you know, they're so wrong to do this. But you have to respond to issues and not the person. You have to be very clear on that. And your spokesperson needs to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't care how intelligent or gifted they are. If they can't do that, they shouldn't be your spokesperson.
Mm-hmm.
And also nonverbal cues are huge. You know, position in the room,
mm-hmm.
The wardrobe that you choose can send a
right.
very real message. So be careful about that. Especially those of us who work with scientists or
mm-hmm.
in the field of science or health, we love our statistics.
Uh-huh.
But the public will perceive them as a way to avoid clear communication.
Mm-hmm.
And the public, by the way, doesn't care about statistics. All risk to them is anecdotal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it may have happened to a million people elsewhere, and I may be wondering, what if it happened here? But until it happens to my neighbor, I'm not really going to worry that much about it. You
right.
see that with disease. I'm sure you see it with cancer all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely.
You know, when it happens to someone we care about, all of a sudden it's a real concern.
Exactly.
So,
how can communication professionals relay technical information most effectively without getting into all this jargon and statistics problem that you talk about?
I like to use examples. Certainly avoid those acronyms and jargon. And be consistent. If you're going to use terminology, be consistent throughout the course of your communication. You know, don't use the word epidemiologist one time and epi the next. And
mm-hmm.
oh, by the way, epidemiologist can be a problem. I used it once when I was trying to convince people that help was on the way, that we were sending epidemiologists to look into a potential disease cluster. And they thought epidemiologist equals epidemic means there is an epidemic. So if you're going to use that term, please do translate it for plain language.
Right.
Also, you can use demonstrations of points to make clear what you're saying. For instance, I do some nuclear power plant drills, and every time in the scenario, there's a leak of radioactive water to the containment room. And, you know, I had visions of a waterfall when it's really about a teacup worth.
Right.
And it's important. It's important to make it clear to people.
Okay. So what's the bottom line here? I think we have a great slide that illustrates your point.
Yeah, I love this slide. It really is. And the bottom line is, the public does not always appear to be rational, and our job as communicators is not to change their rationality, but to understand it and to communicate effectively in that environment. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't have to persuade people. We don't have to decide, announce, and defend. We have to understand why people feel as they do, and we have to communicate effectively through all this noise in the channel.
All right. I'm afraid we don't have time for calls, but we do have one fax here I'd like to read. It's a question in from Vermont. Who will ensure that coordinated messages get to the media? The public will be very confused if they're getting different stories all the time. We just have about 1 minute to go, I'm afraid.
Okay, well, we're working on that right now. We work as a state in New York State. We work as our region. As a matter of fact, I often have discussions with my counterpart at the Department of Health in Vermont.
Mm-hmm.
Recently went to a meeting in Boston to communicate messages through the Northeastern region. Went to one in New York City to communicate through Middle Atlantic. So we understand that's an issue. We're working with the media on that as well, and we'll continue to plug away.
All right. Are there additional resources available to our audience? Our audience will get the slides, but I know we do have one slide here that talks about some of the sources you
absolutely
think are good for
people. These are the people that I want to thank as well. So I would refer you to the CDC website, Agency for Toxic Substance and Disease Registry, the Center for Risk Communication, Dr. Covello's Research Center, the Consortium for Risk and Crisis Communication, which is run by Dr. Vincent Covello and Dr. Tim Tinker. PSandman.com is a wonderful website, and the Society for Risk Analysis has a wealth of resources as well.
Right.
And we're on the credit slide, and I do want to thank all of these folks because I'm a practitioner. I'm not the expert. Right. I like to talk about what the experts have learned. So, and Tom Berry from the South Carolina Department of Health and Environmental Control gave us a lot of these slides. So,
Christine, thank you very much. A very informative hour. I'm afraid we're running out of time, but it's been great, and I'm sure the audience got an awful lot out of it. Thank you out there for joining us today. I'd like you to take a moment to fill out your evaluations, and your thoughts and comments are really important as we plan future programs. Continuing education credits, including nursing contact hours, CME and CHES credits, are available free of charge to viewers who complete the online evaluation and the short post-test. Please visit our website for details. This program, as well as other previous programs, will be available via web streaming online within the week. Please see our website again for an archive collection of past broadcasts. I'm Peter Slocum. I'll see you next time on the University at Albany Center for Public Health Preparedness Grand Round Series.